the summer man aspires, all with Kachina's fire, to bring to fruition truth, the quenching of all desires. Savor the glorious majesty shown in the serpent rise. Our consciousness now ascends, seen through our children's eyes. In this poem, Kachina, serpent equals Kundalini, the consciousness or spirit rising along the chakras of the spine, the goal of yoga and meditation aspirants in the Hindu teachings. Forty-seven, 5:20 p.m., July 23rd, 1945, Rio Grande Road, near Pilar, New Mexico. "But why do we need to go to Bandelier? That's into the lion's den again," Julian shouted to Jade. With the convertible top down, they were kicking up dust in their borrowed Willis Overland Jeep, which Veronica insisted Julian take, though Emil reluctantly parted with his new soft-top four-wheel drive vehicle. They were now roaring past the tiny village of Pilar on the Rio Grande on their way to the Anasazi site, the same road that would have brought them to the base at Los Alamos. They decided to take the low road by the river to avoid detection. "Julian, listen. I've been told there is something there that is very important to both of us. I believe we're justified in stopping to find it on our way south." "I know, but we have at least a 5-hour drive south after we leave Bandelier, across miles of desert, and not all of it is paved. That doesn't leave much time to convince the highest brass in the U.S. Army that they shouldn't blow this next Betsy," Julian pointed out. "That is, if I figure out how to get an audience and bend their ears." "You must trust me, Julian. You heard my mother talk of the voices I have been blessed with since I was a young lady. Well, I've had a premonition that something is going to happen to help us. While I was on Taos Mountain, I had a vision. And just before I met you at the Pueblo, I was visited by a spirit brother, an ancient Hopi medicine man named Red Cloud." Author's note, the historic Red Cloud was actually a warrior, a Lakota Sioux. Julian turned his head to look at her, a dangerous move on this stretch of road due to the frequent rock debris falling on the road from the high cliffs above. "A vision? And an apparition?" He paused, remembering his thought earlier that day about Jade and her strict truthfulness, her flat statement about being an angel-like alien. He took a breath, let it out slowly. "I need a little help here, sweetheart. Slow down and start at the beginning." They hit a smoother stretch of road out of the canyon country nearing Española. Her voice grew softer as the road noise diminished. Julian kicked up the speed a notch. She reached out and took his hand as they drove. "Julian, you're right. Everything I've ever told you is the absolute truth." He looked at her, ready to ask, but she continued, "including my interference with the scheduling for the Trinity test. In truth, this Betsy, this last of its type, is in a dangerous form, and we may have to draw from all my resources in order to stop the test. But don't worry," she looked straight into his eyes, "I've got a few aces up my sleeve." "I don't doubt that. Very little about you could surprise me now." Jade laughed at this. "Don't be so sure." Julian returned. "I was blind to love. I'm still upset about not figuring it out." "If you knew everything, I wouldn't be a mystery," she winked. "A woman's prerogative. Don't reveal everything." He frowned. "Should I ask her about being an angel-like alien?" "Some things you are not ready for yet, dear." Did you just... She looked into his eyes, smiled warmly. "For all eternity, all you will need to know of me is Jade Velasquez, daughter of Emil and Veronica, of Ranchos de Taos. I love you and I always will."
"You know I love you forever, but why can't you tell me? And these things, the visions, the voices, Red Cloud, what is this all about? I must say, curiosity is consuming me. What can you tell me?"
"I'll tell you what I'm permitted, and maybe a little more. I don't follow the rules they've given me very well."
"They? Who's they?"
The Brotherhood. The Directors. Some may say the Elders. My spiritual guides, those I've been listening to for years. Especially since my fall from Borrasca when I was 15, She paused. "Now hear this, Dr. Rose," she mimicked Dr. Paradine, his blowhard nemesis. "You do it my way or you won't do it at all." They both laughed at the spot-on imitation. "Yes, go on," he urged. She stopped for a moment as if she were listening to something inside her head, continued carefully. "Imagine that the cosmos is not exactly as you have been told. Imagine that there is both more direction and more free will than you were ever told about. There are forces, my directors, who are overseeing these variations. This involves the outcome of the war. You have to know that the war and the bomb are two of the biggest things to happen to Earth in its short history." "Short history?" Julian chortled. "Oh, Terra, Earth, that is ancient enough, but your civilization is very young. Relatively, of course. I'm old, myself, but that's another story for another time." He looked at her sideways, shaking his head. "She's telling the truth. I can't believe I'm swallowing this. Something about you always makes me suspend logic, but this, yes, I am telling the truth." In consternation, he waved at the air. Then he looked at her again, brushed the hair from her face, thought, "How can this be?" "It is," she smiled at him, reassuring. As they approached White Rock, a whistle stop where they split off from the road to Los Alamos, Julian said, "This is the road to Bandelier. The closer we get, the more likely our chances of someone spotting you. We should get off the main road." Jade suddenly pointed, "Turn here. Follow the mountain road straight over the pass. We'll drop into Bandelier from the cliffs above. It's steep, but the jeep can do it. This way we can avoid anyone who might be looking for us. Me, that is." He obeyed, turned in, and started up the steep, rocky, and rutty road. "Okay, I'm trying to stay with you here, but maybe we should talk about what we're looking for at the Anasazi site," Julian suggested. "Red Cloud, the medicine man, he told me I could find a talisman there. That's what we're looking for." "Of course, a talisman. Did he give you any clue where?" "I have a method of finding that is not logical. It is purely intuitive. Keep your eyes open. You may learn something," she smiled. "I'm learning something every moment with you." "Eyes open." "Yes," she answered out loud, nestling closer to him. They emerged from the woods above a canyon meadow, as Jade predicted, and followed the path along a clear mountain creek for another 2 miles. The sun was just disappearing over the western rim as they ran along a narrow grassy canyon overseen by a caucus of ancient and fragrant cottonwoods, their leaves shimmering in the evening breeze. In quiet reverence, Jade spoke in a low voice. "This is Bandelier, the ruins of an Anasazi village over 10 centuries old. We used to come here as children to attend meetings of the Pueblo tribes along the Rio Grande. From the northern Taos Pueblo through the Jemez and south to the Sandia and Isleta Pueblos. They were beautiful gatherings of the peaceful Pueblo tribes. The children would play while the elders met in an all-day meeting. Then we would feast and dance all night. I went with Tony Lujan's daughters many times. The Pueblo people say the Anasazi were their ancestors, so they were the last living link to a very advanced civilization. These people were descendants of the Mayans and Incas from South America whose traders ventured north 10,000 years ago." She waited to see if he was taking this in. He clicked off the ignition and they sat there for a moment, listening to the mountain creek and the aspens rustling in the wind on the ridges above. In the quiet and the gathering dusk, the moon was rising above the canyon, and the voices of the Anasazi seemed to be rising out of the ruins of the ancient kivas and cliff dwellings in front of them.